Hi, welcome to latest TV news. I'm Mark Walker. Firstly, I spoke to Anne Ackord, Chief Executive of the Brighton Pier Group, to discuss COVID-19 and what it means for the pier. This is what she had to say. So I'm joined here today by Anne Ackord, who's a Chief Executive of the Brighton Pier Group. Anne, welcome to back to latest TV news. And I know you've been in here before. Last time we spoke actually for the International Women's Day.
That's right, yeah, it was.
Start of the year, and it's been a long year since then, and we've just come towards the end of it. How's it been in regards to the pier? Because I know you've opened up, then you've had to close again. It's been a bumpy ride.
It's been a bumpy ride. It's been, I suppose, you know, to use a pier analogy, it's been a roller coaster of a ride because, you know, way to the back to the, you know, the women's, in, you know, the International Women's Day, and then all of a sudden life changed overnight virtually. So we've been closed, open, closed. It's been a very difficult year. We've tried to do things to, you know, keep the pier alive in the community. But, you know, we employ an awful lot of people. We had, you know, 500 team members that, you know, we were very concerned about at the beginning. And we've had concerns throughout it about, you know, our business and our type of business.
Yeah, and it's you did everything that the government asked you to do, and this is what's been really difficult for companies in the hospitality industry.
Absolutely.
It makes you want to cry, really, doesn't it?
It does, because, you know, the guidelines came out to how you could make yourself safe. And, you know, I don't mind saying that we publish our accounts annually. We spent, prior to reopening in July, about £40,000 getting ready to be COVID safe. That's signage, hand sanitizers, one-way systems, lots of things. And then the cost has crept up on and on because, you know, for example, we have 90 sanitizing stations around the pier, which we fill daily. So all these costs mount up. So along with all the hospitality industry, we did everything we were asked to do. So then for certain sections, not be allowed to open was heartbreaking because these are people's jobs that have been lost forever.
Yeah. Yeah, they've picked on the hospitality industry, even though I know the evidence, we don't need to get into the evidence, but I mean, you know, rates of infection in pubs and in bars, etc. I mean, it's
very low.
Supermarkets are kind of one of the top areas where you like to get infected, and obviously they've remained open throughout. So it's
that's right. It's been very hard on the hospitality industry, and so there have been and will continue to be, throughout this winter particularly, thousands and thousands of redundancies and businesses going into administration that will never open again. This particular period we're going to go through now where we have bars that are not allowed really to sell alcohol, so what are you then? They will not survive, and that's tragic. And, you know, coming up to Christmas, all these people are going to lose their jobs. When I say everything was done to make it safe. If you take, for example, a restaurant where the tables are cleaned every time anyone, a new person comes to it, you know, where the restrooms are refreshed and cleaned every half an hour, that's more than anyone would be doing anywhere. So surely that's a safer environment.
Yeah, exactly. And we had the closing time as well, which I believe is now going to be 11 p.m. But it's difficult, wasn't it? Because I mean, obviously, if you stop. If you're in a pub, you want a drink afterwards,
well,
you're going to go
yeah.
around a friend's house. It's difficult,
exactly.
isn't it?
Exactly, you're just pushing people out all at the same time when normally they would go, you know, at intervals.
Yeah.
You're pushing them into people's houses, which are not as safe as we're being told now.
Yeah.
And 10 o'clock, you know, part of the group that I manage and look after, we don't open our late night bars till 10 o'clock in the evening, so they haven't opened since March. So I have, you know, 12 bars, 12 general managers, 12 teams who have not worked since March.
Yeah.
And there's no sign of them working again yet.
Yeah. Now, we are opening up again. I know Brighton Pier is going to be opening up again.
Tomorrow.
So exactly, tomorrow. And we're looking forward to that. So what can we expect on the pier? Because people are going to want to get out of The seafront has been really busy, hasn't it?
The seafront's been very busy. The last few days has been very busy. So the pier will open again at 12 o'clock tomorrow.
Yeah.
With the rides, the arcades, everything will be open. We've been publishing some special offers on social media. Tomorrow, for example, there's half price wristbands for the rides and various things that you'll pick up from our Twitter and our Instagram feeds. We've got all our COVID safety procedures in place, and we're just looking forward to Christmas and hope for that we can have some bright time in this, what has been a very dark year.
Yeah, and you've got a one-way system there, which works really well. Yes. It's almost designed for a one-way system, actually, the pier, isn't it, really?
In a way it is, yes, because people always walk up one side and come down the other. Yeah. So that has been quite easy to manage.
Yeah.
Obviously, we've got all the restrictions. You know, I have someone who spends their time just reading all the latest guidance that comes out. And we're doing that today, ready for opening and checking what you can or cannot do.
Yeah, exactly. What about the new year then? We're looking into 2021. I mean, hopefully it's going to be much a brighter kind of year for the hospitality industry.
I don't think the first quarter will be, because I think we're looking, you know, all the indications coming from government that we're looking at Easter maybe, with the vaccine coming, which is amazing news. But even so, that's going to take a long time to, you know, to get everyone vaccinated. So we're looking probably towards Easter, you know, end of March time. That's still a long time for all those who are, you know, struggling at the moment. It's 3 months that it's going to kill off a lot of businesses. But if we can get open again, then yes, I think people will be so happy to come out again
that
the rest of 2021, hopefully, if we get good weather, will be a good year.
Got fingers crossed there, so fingers crossed. What Christmas opening hours then? When you open around Christmas?
We're open every day except Christmas Day.
So Boxing Day, we can have that stroll along the pier then?
Stroll on the pier, you can come and eat your post-Christmas donuts, you can go on the rides, and you can sit in the bar as long as you eat.
Yeah.
I think what's the latest story, as long as you eat a Scotch egg or something, isn't it?
But, yeah. One of my favourite foods. So.
Well, you'd be all right. You can. Yes. We'll put them on the menu specially for you.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And just before we finish up, we might need a time capsule for this moment in our time. I know last time I spoke to you, was also about we had a time capsule there.
Yes, we did. We might need
a new one there.
Yes, we might have to add things to it, because no one could have predicted when that went up.
Who would have thought
that, you know, what was going to happen? And please God that, you know, we don't go through this again in our lifetimes. This is something that, you know, that children who, you know, 5-6 year old children will remember.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
If you think back to big crisis when you were a child, there are certain things that stand out. And I know my grandchildren, you know, talk about COVID as if it's a normal part of life now. So that's going to be their memory of 2020. So we need to make sure 2021 has got some better memories.
And our hearts go out to the people that have lost their lives, of
absolutely.
Course, and their families.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And to that, it must be for those who have died through this dreadful virus, then Christmas must be a heartbreaking time. So our thoughts certainly go to them, and to anyone who is suffering from anxiety, loneliness, depression, because it is very difficult to be on your own and without contact for so long.
Yeah, and we wish them a very good 2021, and
absolutely.
All the best. And Anne Ackord, thanks for joining us today, and all the best as well with the new opening. Cheers, thanks a lot. We now get an update from the Chailey Heritage Foundation. Yael Breuer takes up the story.
Chailey Heritage Foundation are embarking on a very special fundraising initiative, and the funding manager, Jenna Durdle, is here with me. Well, not quite with me, but via Zoom. And Jenna, I'm very excited to hear about this project, because it sounds very revolutionary in a way. It's an up-to-date, exciting learning environment, playground for the children of Chailey Heritage, isn't it? But before you tell me about the actual initiative, could you tell me a little bit about the school itself, please?
Yeah, so Chailey Heritage Foundation is a charity that provides education and care for young people with disabilities. And as part of that, we have a special school for children from the age of 4 right up to 19. And it really is an incredible place. The young people there have very complex disabilities, but everything is tailored to their individual needs. So not only does it support their educational, their learning needs, but also the health needs that they have. And some of the young people there have very complex health needs. So they may access therapy during the day, as well as you know, normal lessons or you know, or more sort of conventional learning. It's also about supporting their health needs.
So it's a real kind of comprehensive package, if you like. And I guess it's been particularly challenging over the last few months with them adapting to restrictions of COVID. Would you say that's been the case?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the one thing that I would say is that the school has created a really stable environment for the children throughout the pandemic so that things can feel as normal as possible for them. So whilst a lot of schools had to close in those early days, mainstream schools, as a school that provides education for children with an education healthcare plan, we stayed open. So even during these holidays, we stayed open. All the staff have been wearing PPE and working around things so that they can keep social distancing and really just try and keep that normality going for children who often feel anxious by different environments or different situations. So it's been really important.
Jenna, thank you so much and best of luck.
That's it for the first half. Join me for the second half for a very special Christmas song. We match cricket with Christmas and look back on cycle safety. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. I spoke to the songwriter and Latest TV colleague Yael Breuer about her very special Christmas song. So I hope you have a happy Christmas time, and Yael, you're here with a new song for Christmas, and we need a good Christmas jingle, don't we, at the moment? So tell us about this song that I know you wrote on Christmas Day. While yes. Everyone else was eating the mince pies, you were writing songs.
Yeah, we were creative. Well, it was my friend Eyal Shavit and I. We were sitting at my house on Christmas Day. Eyal and I had already written a book, Hilarious Hebrew, so we kind of knew that we worked well creatively. And I actually telling him that all these really big Christmas songs from, you know, way back were written by Jewish people. Did you know that? I know you were talking about the Bing Crosby song the other day.
Yeah.
Well, that was written by Irving Berlin, otherwise known as Israel Balin.
Right.
You know, chestnuts yeah. roasting
the
on
classics.
An open fire, all the classics. So I said to Eyal, why don't we do the same?
I like that. I hope you have a happy Christmas time. Because I need to hear that message. You know, it's been a tough year, hasn't it? So it's quite uplifting, that
thing. Yeah, it's one
we're
of these really cheesy, cliched yeah. Christmas song, but it works.
It works. So then we're going to take a listen.
It's time to get together and celebrate as one. Let's sing a song for Christmas. Unite the old and young. And gathering round the fire. Glasses filled with wine. We hope you have a happy Christmas. Time with friends and family you've been longing for all year. You can tell them that you miss them now that they're all here. Now Granny's eyes are twinkling, the children's faces shine. We hope you have a happy Christmas time. Santa will arrive. Shh, his bag full of surprises. He knows how good you've been. So till the morning comes, hold hands and sing.
All right, Yael, thanks for coming today. All the best with the song, and I look forward to hearing it again nearer to Christmas time. Cheers.
Delicious.
Thanks. Now flat mix of cricket and Christmas, William Ranieri reports.
In the Bag is an initiative from a Sussex Cricket Foundation and Brighton Hove Food Partnership to fight food poverty by delivering kit containing easy recipe and ready-weight out ingredients distributed to family in need as identified by the City Emergency Food Network. You can help the campaign by donating on the Just Giving page and looking for Guerrilla Cricket in the Bag. I went to the cricket ground to find out more.
The food partnership is all about food in the city. So we teach people about growing food, we teach people about cooking food, and we teach people about wasting less food. But over the last few months, we've been doing a lot of work around emergency food, around people who've needed help because of the COVID pandemic. Over the summer, we had a target of doing 1,200 bags, and we just went over just over that. So they went out every single week over the 6 weeks of the summer holidays to different families. At one point, we were doing 3,000 emergency food parcels a week. And although that's gone down now to about 1,000, 1,200, it's an awful lot more than before the crisis when it was about 420. You'd be really surprised, it happens across the whole city. And actually, some of the places that you think might be wealthier have real pockets of individuals who are really struggling. So I think the situation is that anybody can lose their job, anybody can be in a situation they can't pay the rent, and then suddenly are really struggling to pay for food. Our website is bhfood.org.uk, and it's full of information about recipes, about tips, and about our wider work.
So we're approached in the summer by the Brighton Hove Food Partnership and with Vic to help provide meals to families in need across the city. We run the programme over the summer, which went really well, and we were looking to do it again next summer anyway, but we were approached by a cricket website called Gorilla Cricket, who saw our initiative and wanted to help support a winter edition. So we're only too pleased to support that with Vic's support as well. So we've set a target of raising £3,500, which will provide 1,000 food bags to families across the city in this really challenging time. So if you'd like to donate, then full information is on our website, sussexcricket.co.uk. Click on the latest news, you'll find all the details about in the bag and how to donate. So please support. Cricket in Sussex is growing, and it's growing rapidly, even despite the COVID crisis. We do a lot of work in schools, not just across the city, but also across the county, giving as many boys, girls, males and females the opportunity to play cricket as possible. And even during this challenging summer, we still managed to play a lot of cricket, which is really pleasing.
Finally, we look back on an innovative cycle safety initiative from Brighton Hove Buses. Here is my report. So I'm here today with Ed Knight, and we're here to look at bus safety. Welcome to Latest TV News, Ed. First of all, what's your role and why are you here today?
Thank you very much for that. Yes, my role within the company for Brighton and Hove Buses and also for Metro Bus in Crawley, I'm the insurance and claims manager. And we're actually here today to demonstrate for safety purposes where the blind spot is in the mirror with cyclists. How we're actually doing it is we're asking cyclists to come along, sit in the bus, and then we show them what the view is like for the driver, which a lot of cyclists are actually very surprised what the view is, because they are big, they are long vehicles. Yeah. So they really get a hands-on effect of this is what it's like by exchanging places.
Yeah.
Okay, right, well, you're sat in the driver's seat of the bus now, and what you've got to think of is what the bus driver can see. The bus driver is busy looking in the near side mirror. He's also looking in this interior mirror, which is showing the passengers downstairs. Also, just in front of him, he's got a camera that's showing him what's happening upstairs on the bus. Then he's also got the offside mirror, which is showing him obviously what's happening on that offside of the bus. And in between looking at these four, he's also got to be able to look where he's going and what he's doing, whether he's going to be accelerating, braking, etc. Now, if I go round to the other side of the bus on the offside, I can explain where the large spot is, the blind spot on the mirror. So I'll just go round the other side for you. Okay, so I'm on the offside of the bus now. Now, what you've got to think of is the bus driver is looking in these four mirrors, three mirrors and a camera, shall I say, right? So he can't look only in this offside mirror all the time. He's also got to look where he's going and what he's doing with the various bus controls, right? So what I'd like you to do now is look in this offside mirror, right? And you can see the bus behind you, right? But if, for an example, you're a cyclist, and I stand here and I'm on my cycle, can you see me in that offside mirror? And then I come up and I'm level with the bus, can you see me in the mirror? Right? And I have to go all the way back, and presumably you still can't see me in the mirror. So what I'm going to do now is, while you're looking through the offside mirror, I'm going to ask a cyclist to come down the offside of the bus and then you will see where the blind spot is. So if the driver is busy looking where he's going and looking in the other mirrors and the camera, a cyclist can creep up on the bus driver. So I'll get the cyclist to run down the offside of the bus. So here comes the cyclist now. If you look in that mirror, and you'll be able to see when do they disappear. They're not there. So if you as a bus driver are busy looking where you're going, looking in the mirror, watching your passengers, looking at the passengers for the safety and comfort of them, a cyclist can arrive on the offside of the bus and he's in the blind spot. And that's the danger zone. So we want to emphasise to cyclists where the blind spots are on a bus, and that's what we're doing today.
Cycling is fantastic for you. Its health benefits, both physical, mental, and indeed your pockets, are great. But there is a risk there. It's outweighed about 20 times the one to the small risk that there is in the roads. And obviously, I want to minimise this. Yeah. It's awareness both of drivers, of cyclists, and of pedestrians as well. Yeah. Pedestrian walkouts, that kind of thing, is a problem. And of course, cyclists doing the wrong thing, like going through red lights, etc., put the passengers on buses at risk if a bus driver's got to emergency stop, all those kind of things. So we want to minimise the risk.
Because there's an increasing amount of bikes in Brighton, we've got a good cycle lane provision. So the risk has been higher, is it because there's more cyclists on the streets in Brighton?
Well, I think it's just a question of we work very closely and in harmony with cyclists. We do a lot of work with Sussex University. We've held a similar event twice at Sussex University where we work with the cyclists there because there's a lot of cyclists that go to university. We've held these events before within Brighton, and by working closely together, you eliminate the possibility, really, of any incidents.
I mean, how can people find out more information? How can they be more aware? Apart from attending today's event, what else can people do, or what can the council do to make people more aware?
Well, we've got a Facebook page, Share the Roads Brighton and Hove, and there are videos on there. And if you look online, the Met Police in London have got an excellent Exchanging Places VR film, which enables you to get the complete feeling of what it's like to be the driver and to be the cyclist. Yeah. So you can do that quite easily, and we've got much more information online as well.
That's it for today. Join us for tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Good night.